بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. طبعا النهاردة احنا بنستضيف الأستاذ دكتور فيصل شاهين من المملكة العربية السعودية. طبعا دكتور فيصل حبيب المصريين والدول العربية كلها، وهو طبعا سواء في السعودية أو في مصر وما بين أهله ومحبيه، يعني شعبيته في زمان في السعودية موجودة بكثرة، موجودة في دول الخليج وفي مصر على الخصوص، لأنه طبعا له جذور في مصر. ويمكن السي في ده انا جابه من على الموقع بتاع مركز الدكتور سليمان الفقيه، اللي طبعا العالمي الشهير اللي هو جي سي اي اكريديت فور ميني تايمز ناو. الدكتور فيصل طبعا اتخرج من المنصوره، جامعه المنصوره، فطبعا الجامعه الام بتاعتنا الحبيبه سنه 80، وتدرج. انا مش هقول كل الشهادات اللي حصل عليها لانها كتيره جدا جدا جدا، والخبرات الدولية يعني لا تعد ولا تحصى. يمكن من الحاجات العلامات الفارقة في الكارير بتاع الدكتور فيصل شاهين انه كان دايركتور جنرال السعودي سنتر فور اورجان ترانسبلانتيشن من سنة 93 ل 2018. ومن خلال رئاسته لهذا المركز المتميز جدا جدا بامكانياته، وطبعا الكواليتي اشورنس اللي بيتحقق من خلال السعوديه والخليج، اثرى موضوع زراعه الاعضاء بشكل كبير جدا. هو دكتور فيصل الفاوندر اوف جده كيدني سنتر 93، اكسكتيف اديتور اوف اس جي كي دي تي سنه 94، كونسلر ممبر اوف ترانسبلانتيشن سوسايتي تي تي اس والدي اي جي سي، مش عارف اختصار بتاعها ايه، والميسوت طبعا الميدل ايست سوسايتي والانترناشونال سوسايتي اللي انا حضرت المؤتمر بتاعها الاخير لما هو توج رئيسا لها بريزنت اليكت في 2019، وان شاء الله يعني دايما الى الامام. وهو حاليا كوتشيرمان اوف ذا دونيشن اند ترانسبلانتيشن تاسك فورس اوف ذا دبليو اتش او وورلد هيلث اورجانيزيشن. Scientific achievements a lot. يعني أنا يعني الكلام ده موجود على السي في بتاع حضرتك، وفي activities كتيرة جدا مش قاصرة على renal transplantation. ده كل الorgan transplantation, cardiac, lung, cornea. A lot of activities بصراحة حاجة جميلة جدا، ومش مقتصرة على Middle East، ده ممتدة إلى أوروبا وأمريكا والinternational sites. يمكن في دقيقة برضو أحب أشارك بعض الصور. طبعاً ده صورة من مؤتمر الأورجان دونيشن سنة 2015. الصورة دي حضرتك معتز بها، حاططها على البروفايل أعتقد مع الانترناشنال سوسايتي اللي هي الجمعية اللي حضرتك انتخبت رئيساً لها في العام الماضي أعتقد هذا. طبعاً مع البروفيسور سوزان، وطبعاً نتمنى لحضرتك كل الرقي. في الجمعية المصرية سنة 2018 ديت برضو كانت من الجلسة اللي حضرتك كلمت فيها، وكان معانا الدكتور سعيد الغامدي مع الدكتور جمال السعدي والدكتور طارق هنا في مصر، والصورة دي عن قرب. ده في المؤتمر اللي حضرناه اللي حضرتك انتخبت فيه رئيس للآي اس طبعا انترناشونال سوسايتي اوف اورجان دونيشن اند بروكريتمنت. ويمكن احنا طبعا حضرتك برضو بتتميز بروح المرح، مش كله يعني صرامة وعلم، وانا دايما سعيد جدا بشوف حضرتك لانه ده زي ما حضرتك شايف كده انا مبتسم جدا اهوت، ومتاكد النهارده خلال المحاضره الجميله اللي هناخد فيها خبرات من سعادتك، حضرتك اخترت عنوان جميل جدا جذاب جدا، يعني يمكن الدكتور فيصل يعني هناخد من حضرتك ان شاء الله بعد الكورونا ما تختفي موضوع الديسيز دونر كيني ترانسبلانتيشن، ممكن الدكتور احمد حلاوه يشاركنا في هذا اليوم ان شاء الله. لكن انا فضلت ان احنا نبدا بالعنوان ده اللي هو Predictability and Risk Factors of New Onset Diabetes After Transplantation، اللي أنا متأكد إن كل اللي معانا وإن شاء الله اللي هيتابعوه على اليوتيوب هيستمتعوا وهيستفيدوا من خبرة حضرتك الكثيرة جدا. أنا سعيد جدا بوجودك يا دكتور فيصل، وأتمنى إن شاء الله طبعا يعني يوم يكون موفق، وإن شاء الله تبقى دي بداية تعاون مثمر ما بيننا وبين حضرتك. أنا هستوب الشير من عندي وحضرتك تبدا تشير اليور برزنتيشن. جميل.
اوكي.
اوكي.
أولا بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. I would like first to thank you, Dr. Hussein, for this kind introduction, which probably I don't deserve it, but I'm happy to share anything with Egyptian society, Egyptian colleague. They are my friend, my brother, and my sisters, all of them. I work with them as one of them, and we are in Arab, we are almost brothers and sisters. Again, I'm happy for you to contact me because I like Mansoura and I work in Mansoura. I stayed in Mansoura for a long time in my life. So this, you bring to me all the memories when I was young and enthusiastic, and probably you don't know I was, maybe I'm senior than you, so I'm older than you when I was in Mansoura. But I am very happy always to see colleague from Mansoura because this is a very special place to me in my life. And again, I would like to thanks Dr. Halawa and Dr. Tariq to join us as a chairperson for this important meeting, which I think the subject which I chose, it's very important for all of us as a physician, not only a nephrologist, but it is also for the others, physicians, as because they can meet such patients after transplantation. I chose, let me just share the full screen so
yes,
it will be easy for me. Okay.
على الشاشة التلفزيون يا باشا اضغط على بتاع التلفزيون
اوكي
اف 5
حاضر حاضر يا استاذ اف 5
اوكي لا اطلع من حضرتك علمت في داخل العنوان حضرتك اضغط على التلفزيون اللي تحت او اف 5 من واطلع من العنوان
طيب دقيقة معلي
خد وقتك
اوكي ولا هنستمر كده زي ما نحن
طبعا لا لا لا, لا 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 هو حضرتك نشر على التلفزيون صح من تحت
اوكي نوتس نو كليك تو اد نوتس نو واي ات از نوت هير
التلفزيون تحت يا باشا بس صغير
ام تراينج
على ما حضرتك تفتح البرزنتيشن
Okay,
why I selected the topic of post-transplant diabetes to start with, because we experienced post-transplant diabetes we have a post-transplant diabetes in our experience. We have now more than 3,000 cases of live donor kidney transplantation. Diabetes is diagnosed post-transplant in 22%. This is the incident, the total cumulative incidence or prevalence of post-transplant diabetes at Mansoura Urology and Nephrology Center. This
okay,
one, sure. Start by this. Okay.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Hussein. Really, it is important problem to be followed by the physician and transplant physician and also with any physicians who deal with the transplantation. And my talk will be about the epidemiology of the disease and also the definition, because there are many definitions about this diabetes, either it is diabetic after transplantation or a new diagnosed diabetic or it is transient diabetic. So many people just confused. What is this diabetes? Is it new things? It is diabetes type 2, it's type 1, it is no one. Actually, so many names about this, and I will discuss this in detail. So I will speak also about the risk factors and the pathogenesis of hyperglycemia post-transplantation and the outcome of post-transplant diabetes mellitus. And also I will speak about the approach to the therapy, and just a few slides about the therapy and our experience, like what you have in Mansoura University about their experience. Now, diabetes is very important. Why it is important? Because it is a very risky for the patient, for the recipient. And we can find the diabetic after transplantation in kidney, heart, liver, and lung. All the transplantation, the patients can have diabetes after transplantation. The incidence is varied between in kidney 4 to 50%, and in heart 11 to 38% of the patient can develop diabetes. In liver 7 to 30%, and in lung 30 to 35%. Why is this? You can just by following the slide, you will understand why this the variations. First, because of the definition of the diabetes. Is it new onset diabetes or is it diabetes? Did we consider the patients who develop hyperglycemia immediately post-transplant that they develop diabetes, or we didn't consider them? So that's a variation between 40 to 50, 50 in post-transplantation. And as we know that, all of us know that diabetes is very, very nasty disease and very dangerous disease, and it can end the patient to have a graft failure. Also, it increases the incidence of cardiovascular disease and diabetic nephropathy, which can again affect the graft, and it will be aggressive when it is affecting the graft. Here, there is from a study from Farm, which shows the incidence of post-transplant diabetes. In 3 months, we can have 9.2% of our patients develop diabetes. And in 12 months, this number increased to 18%. And in 36 months, it's 24%, which is the case probably everywhere in the world about this important disease. In Saudi Arabia, unfortunately, we are one of the highest country to have diabetes post diabetes as a whole. But also, the definition of diabetes, there is our colleague Al-Aid, he reports post-transplant diabetes incidence of 27% among 500 patients. There is one study which I share myself, I will just show it in the end of my talk. And Al-Aid, actually, he looked and he found that the age and family history and hepatitis C and impaired fasting glucose, all of this are contributing factors to have diabetes post-transplantation. And the definition of his diabetes is glucose more than 7 millimole or signs of diabetes with the history of diabetes mellitus. So it's a little bit the choosing patient is different from what we had in our study. So what's the definition exactly of post-transplant diabetes? Either we will have either the patient have symptom of diabetes plus random blood glucose more than 200 milligram per deciliter, which is equal around 11.1 millimole, or fasting blood glucose more than 126 milligram per deciliter, or 2 hour plasma glucose more than 200 milligram per deciliter, or the HbA1c more than 6.5%. So this is the one who had diabetes, to categorize him, this is a diabetic patient. And still, the glucose tolerance, oral glucose tolerance test is considered to be the gold standard for diagnosis of post-transplant diabetes. But again, HbA1c should not be at all used to screen post-transplant diabetes mellitus in the first few months post-transplantation. So we have to exclude HbA1c if it is high. Immediately post-transplant, we should ignore it, but we should go with oral glucose tolerance test, which is more specific. There is a lot of meeting to discuss about the definitions, about the outcome of post-transplant diabetes. It's worldwide. That's why there is the name change. Either it is new onset diabetes, or it is diabetic post-transplantation. And it is fixed now, it is post-transplant diabetes mellitus. So, but still the term, which is new onset diabetes after transplantation, is still going on in many places, but the name which is being decided worldwide by the consensus or the recommendation is the post-transplant diabetes mellitus. So they changed the terminology from new onset diabetes after transplant to post-transplant diabetes mellitus. And they exclude all post-transplant hyperglycemia, which is again another definition, is post-transplant hyperglycemia to post-transplant diabetes mellitus. And they expand the screening test for post-transplant diabetes using post-prandial glucose monitoring HbA1c to raise the suspicions, while glucosterol test is still the most important test to check either the patients have diabetes or not. And identify the patient, the most transplant diabetes mellitus, and use strategy to prevent and treat beyond modification of the immunosuppression drug. So we have to look for the strategy to treat the diabetes and not to pay attention too much to the immunosuppression. We have to modulate it a little bit, but not to think that we have to have major changes in immunosuppression, and then the patients can develop rejection and they can lose the graft. Why we consider it is both transplant diabetes and not new onset diabetic after transplant? Why? Because there are many undiagnosed diabetes in kidney transplant. It is a case finding strategy, and this is a research from Henrik Andresen, which it is a cross sectional study in 889 first transplant candidate without diabetes, and he studies complete glycemic data, fasting blood glucose, 2-hour postprandial and HbA1c pre-transplantation. What's his result of this 889? He found that only 22% of the patients with diabetes had diabetic by fasting blood glucose. Only 22%. And then when he performed glucose tolerance test, and he found that 90% of those patients have diabetes, which again, this means that the accurate, first, some patients which we can face glucose between 92 to 125, we consider them as not having diabetes. They really have diabetes if we perform the glucose tolerance test after that. So it's proved that 90% of the cases, even with the normal blood sugar, which we consider as normal blood sugar, they already pre-diabetic or diabetic. What is the risk factors to have diabetes post transplantation? It is three things: either non-modifiable, so we cannot do anything with this, and potentially modifiable and modifiable case. So we can do something at least with the potentially modifiable. We can modify some risk factor and then we can have a good outcome, or we can completely mold it from the start. Any patient who can, we can play with the medications, or we can play with his status. So the non-modifiables, which again, African-American, we cannot change anything. We cannot do anything about this. Age also, we cannot do, because the elderly patient, usually they develop diabetes, and the young patient usually didn't develop. Recipient is a cat over, if he's male or female, we cannot do anything. Again, tissue typing, we cannot do anything. And if the patient develop acute rejection, this is also prone that he may have developed the diabetes later on. And the source of the donor, if it is deceased, this means that the patients can develop diabetes post-transplantation. And if the donor is male also, this, it's noticed that the patients can develop diabetes, and it is in polycystic kidney disease. So if this is, we cannot do anything about this, but there is something which we can do. If there's some patients who had hepatitis C, we should treat hepatitis C before transplantation. So at least he will have a chance not to develop any diabetes post-transplantation. If the patient CMV positive, we should treat him. And if glucose tolerance test is positive, we can put him again in a specific diet or medication to treat the hyperglycemia. If he had proteinuria, we can do something about him. And magnesium, if he had low magnesium, we can treat the low magnesium before transplantation. And something, which is modifiable, which we can do something, the medication. We have medications which can cause hyperglycemia, like tacrolimus, cyclosporine, steroid, mTOR inhibitor, anti-CDB5. All of them we can play in the limit of it, but not to extend that to stop it. If we stop it, we may lose the graft. So we have some medication which we can play, and we will discuss this further. Obesity, one of the important factors which very important to be treated. Even post-transplant, it can help to reduce the incidence of diabetes. This is the independent factors to have diabetes, which is, as I mentioned before, and there is the risk factors to develop diabetes. Age, aging is important, is considered to be 1.9 as a risk factor. If it is more than 60 years, so we have more risk factor, which is 2.6. BMI, if it is high, just an example, between 25 to 30 kg, 1.4, the risk factor. If it's increased more than 30, the risk factor increased to 1.7. African-American, this we cannot make any change in it, but it is they have more incidence of diabetes post-transplantation. Hispanic is, again, we can't do, but still it is one of the risk factors. Immunosuppressions, tacrolimus, the risk factor is 1.53, MMF 0.78, and hepatitis C antibodies 1.3%. So there are some of those are potentially modifiable, which we can work in it before after transplantation. But what about the relation between hyperglycemia and the insulin treatment after transplantation? If we have a patient who already in the hospital and he didn't develop at all hyperglycemia post-operative, is he prone to have diabetes or not? Or if he developed hyperglycemia immediately post-operative? This is a retrospective cohort study, includes 377 patients with post-transplant diabetes, 4% of them without diabetic during when they were inpatient. And the patient who developed hyperglycemia later on, 30% of them were diagnosed as inpatient hyperglycemia. So if any patient who is in the hospital post-transplantation and he developed hyperglycemia, most probably 30% of them, they will have diabetes later on, which is very important, again, observation. And so the inpatient, which have more blood sugar, more than 200 milligram, and hyperglycemia by definition of the therapy, or he developed many times, they require insulin. This means that most probably, or 70% of those patients can develop diabetes after a few months or years. Here we can see again the effect of the medication. Tacrolimus, which is important cause of the diabetic post-transplant, and this here you can see the patients with no tacrolimus, which is in the low, the curve here, which show that they don't have diabetes, or at least mostly the diabetes is less than the patients who had tacrolimus. So if the patient with tacrolimus, most probably he can have some diabetic post-transplantation. There are three studies here which show the tacrolimus level. The trough level, if it is in early phase of using FK or Brograf or tacrolimus, we were using usually a very high dose in the start. And our reference was a little bit more than 10 to 25 milligram per mil. And that's why we were having a lot of diabetic post-transplantation. And this study from Birch, GD, in 1997, and you can see this is the early phase of FK uses, and 90% of the patients were having diabetes with the reference with the trough level of between 10 to 25. And when we start to decrease the dose in 2000, Johnson reported that the incidence of diabetes come down to 6.5. And then when we start to decrease it more and decrease more the level, of the trough levels, we decrease it less than before. So we come down to a lesser number, which is the 5-point-something with post-transplant. So again, if the level of the tacrolimus level is high, we will have high blood sugar. And so we have to be a little bit that the level of the tacrolimus post-transplant should be adjusted, and otherwise it will affect the blood sugar. And again, if we look for cyclosporine, is cyclosporine diabetogenic? Yes, it is. but not like tacrolimus. Tacrolimus is more diabetogenic than the cyclosporine. But here you can see the level, if it is high more than 200 milligrams per mil in the first year, the diabetic is 6.4%. And if we give a low dose of cyclosporine, the trough level is 100 milligrams, only the diabetes is 4.7%. What about the steroid? Which again, I will have a few slides about steroid, but because I think it is important to know the relation between steroid and diabetes. As all of us know that chronic use of steroid lead to hyperglycemia in even either dialysis patients or non-dialysis patients. If someone, dialysis, transplant, or non-normal people, if they use steroid, this can give more hyperglycemia. And in transplantation, if late withdrawal of the steroid, it doesn't affect the outcome after many years. And this is, I will show it, some studies show that. So we, as a physician, not to be hurry to move the steroid quickly. We have probably to give a steroid for some time and then maintain it also in a lowish dose, not to be in hurry to remove it. So lower rate with low steroid maintenance dose can lead to rejection. So at least we should be caution when we take out the steroid. So still 0.1 milligram per kg, prednisolone, 4% increase in glucose tolerance test. So still it can have effect in the blood sugar, but it's the long term, it will not affect the graft. Again, I will see one study which shows there's 277 patients. This is from J.D. Birch in an American Journal of Transplantation 2015. 277 patients randomized into chronic steroid and early corticosteroid withdrawal. 135 used steroid for a long time, and other numbers, 142 have withdrawal. All patients receive steroid in the first 7 days. So all take the steroid in 7 days, then they randomize them. Some take low dose of steroid, 5 milligram, and the other doesn't take any steroid. And this is 5-year study, which is very important. And the conclusion was limited impact in reducing diabetic post-transplant when it is compared to low dose of 5 milligrams. So there is very little impact. I know that some people have in their mind that steroid is not necessary, but it is. It is one of the conclusion in the Congress maybe in 2016 in London, EDITA, the conclusion was mainly that even 5 milligrams of steroid important for some patient and not to take it easily from the patient, they made a bit of rejection. Here another study, which is a Harmony study. It's open label, multi-center randomized control study, 615 kidney transplantations with low risk is 1:1:1. We have 3 arms here. Bezolixamab induction with low dose FK, MMF, and steroid. And the arm B is the rapid steroid withdrawal in day seven. And arm C, they add ATG, again without steroid, after eight days. And the conclusion, biopsy-proven acute rejection rate were not reduced post-diabetic transplantation in arm B and C. And rapid steroid withdrawal reduced post-transplantation DM in arm B to 24%, and in arm C, 23%, compared to arm A, which have maintenance therapy significantly. So again, post-transplant diabetes can happen with different protocol, but still there is significant changes if we use it for a long term or not. But the long term in lowish dose will not affect too much the outcome of the kidney transplantation. It is you have to deal with this in a very good way, because if you think that your patient is risky to avoid, to take out the steroid, don't take it, leave it. But if you think your patient is very good, compatible, the donor and the recipient, and he don't need steroid, take it out, but not in the first phase. You can take it you can give it for 5 to 10 days post transplantation, and then you can withdraw it and keep your patient steroid free. There are again about the steroid again, we still the incidence of post transplant diabetes in de novo kidney transplantation recipient with prolonged tacrolimus based immunosuppression, because again you have two drugs which can affect the blood sugar. And this study is randomized study, open label, 24 weeks study in 1,081 patients. All the patients received prolonged release tacrolimus, bezalixamab, MMF, and they take one bolus of intraoperative steroid, 1 gram during operation. Arm one received tablet dose of steroid, stopped after 10 days. Arm two, there is no received steroid after intraoperative bolus. So just only take one dose only of steroid intraoperative. And the conclusion was prolonged release tacrolimus, bezalixamab, and the MMF, Mofetil is a good and efficient, and there is low incidence of post-transplant diabetes, and it is manageable profile over 24 weeks. And there is a lower incidence of biopsy-proven acute rejection was seen in patients receiving steroid. So it's still destroyed, even if we give it for only 10 days. It is effective, and it's important to be given. And probably after that, you decide either you remove it or not, especially if you have a good arm in your tacrolimus, bezalixamab, and some of those potent drugs. This is our study, which we did in Saudi Arabia, me and many colleagues from different centers in the kingdom. And we were looking for serum glucose level immediately post-transplantation and the incidence of diabetes post-transplantation in our study. As I mentioned, in the retrospective study, we have adult kidney transplant. This is the inclusion criteria from January 2004 to 2013, and there is no history or evidence of pre-transplant diabetes in those patients. And patients who lost their graft within 12 months were excluded from this study. What we found that we have 15% of our patients develop diabetic after transplantation, and 85% didn't develop any transplantation. This is 5 years, after 5 years. So again, as I mentioned before, that if we just categorize who will develop the diabetes and who will not develop diabetes, the age was very important, as I mentioned, and the weight, which is again important, that mostly if the patient is overweight, he will develop diabetes and BMI going with the weight. And fasting blood sugar, it wasn't important in 24 hours, but also was not important. And the highest level of glucose is not important. And again, even blood sugar in 6 months is 1 year was very important in such patients. And serum creatinine was not important. So what we found in short, that the patient who developed diabetes, and in their McDoot, if the BMI is high, if the fasting blood glucose at 24 hour is high, if the age is important, and again, DM is very important, and history of the family of diabetes mellitus in the family is very important. And in our group, the prevalence of diabetic after transplantation is the period in 4.6 years was 15.5%. In USA, the incidence there is 26% at 3 years. This is if we compare ourselves from the study from USA. So our study suggests that the first degree family history of diabetes is highly predictive to develop diabetes post-transplantation in Saudi population. Again, this is important slide, which I think it is. This is the evolution of the diabetic bone transplantation. It is a complex, a little bit, but if we read it carefully, it will show to us what will happen to the to those patients. So immediately, post transplantations, we can have diabetes in around 30% to 90%. Okay, 32% of our patients can have, of any patients can have diabetes post transplantation. And this 32% will continue after 36 months. This is the 3 months. After 30 months, 49% or 50% of them, they will become normal. So there is no diabetes. And 20% will become pre-diabetic, and 30% will continue to have diabetic post transplantation. Again, if we look to the category which is pre-diabetic patients here, the pre-diabetic, what will happen to them? 42% will become normal after 36 months, and 36% of them will be continue to be like pre-diabetic, and 20% of them will have fixed diabetic bone transplantation. So if we go to the normal people, which doesn't have anything bone transplantation, so they don't have diabetes, and after 36 months, 94% of them will be normal, continue to be normal, and 13% will be pre-diabetic, and only 1.85% will have diabetes. So the conclusion from this difficult slide, which I think if we understand it well, it will be good and guide us, that the patient who will never develop diabetic, he will continue not to have diabetic. Only few of them can have bone transplantation. And the patient which is pre-diabetic, he can continue to be pre-diabetic, or he develop frank diabetes after transplantation. What about the management of diabetic bone transplantation? So we have to think about diabetes before we go for transplantation. So any risk assessment, we should do it before. If the patient have hepatitis C, we should treat it. If they had hypomagnesemia, we should treat it. If the patient have CMV, we should treat it. So if the patient overweight, we should give them advice not to go for transplantation till they lose some weight. So we have to work in this before transplantation. And then, so in evaluation, we have to consider the important things which I mentioned may develop diabetes, especially the age, if there is family history of type 2 diabetes, if there is personal history of diabetic post transplant in the previous transplant, most probably he will develop again another diabetic. And if glucose tolerance is impaired, so we should think about, and as I mentioned, BMI, if it is more than 30, and hepatitis C, all of this, we should think that those are prone to have diabetic post transplantation, and we should be cautious about them and screen them and follow them carefully. What about KDIGO recommendations for the diabetic post-transplantation? So they recommend non-diabetic for if the blood or to check for plasma glucose, oral glucose tolerance test, and for 4 weeks weekly post-transplantation, and then every 3 months for 1 year, and then annually after that. So follow-up of the patient to check either he developed diabetes or not is mandatory, either immediately post-operative or later on. So immediately post-operative, we make the time is less. So weekly, we have to check the blood sugar and for 4 weeks, and then 3 months, and then annually after that. So screening also is important with fasting glucose tolerance test, as I mentioned before. And HbA1c, immediately post-transplant is not necessary, but later on, you can use it and utilize it as a good test to follow up your patient, especially if he had CNI and steroid. The non-pharmacological management of the diabetic post-transplantation is dietary modifications, and again, vegetarian-style diet is recommended, and it is associated with less insulin, with less diabetic post-transplant, and we also target low cholesterol, which is less than 200 milligram per day for those patients. And modifications in lifestyle, exercise is important post-transplant, weight reduction is important, and to avoid excessive weight gain, and smoking cessation is also very important. And the management is important, again, it's a little bit different from the non-transplant patient. So if we have some patients who need modifications of immunosuppression, we should be carefully modify the immunosuppression drug, but we have to observe the creatinine and observe the sign of rejection. We are not targeting only the blood glucose to be in the range, but also we don't like the graft to be rejected. So it is very important to look for both sides when you are going to reduce any medication or modulate any immunosuppression medication. So the algorithm of the management in short will be the suggested treatment in both transplant diabetes. In the first month after transplant, we have to bring down the fasting glucose less than 7 millimole and post-prandial glucose less than 10 millimole. And the treatment mainly immediately post-trans will be insulin. No oral medication immediately post-transplant. We have to give insulin, dietary advice, and encourage physical activity. This is immediately post-transplant. Later on, we can deal with them like type 2 diabetic. In maintenance treatment, fasting glucose, we should target to be less than 7 millimole, post-prandial glucose less than 10, and HbA1c less than 7.5. Again, the treatment, the long-term treatment is dietary, physical activities, continue insulins, and then shift it to glucose lowering agent tablet if you can manage to do that, and then think to come down with your steroid therapy to 5 milligram daily, and FK liver, try to make it between 3 to 7 milligram. And what's the recommended hypoglycemic agent? Usually the same medication like Januvia, Galfas, Amaryl, Diamicron. By the way, Diamicron, I think today there is something about Diamicron. Internationally, that there is some carcinogenic in the one of them, but anyhow, we have to be sure this. Someone said the only one, the drug only in USA have this, but we don't have it. So, metformin, we have to think again about lactic acidosis, and we usually to avoid it if we don't have good creatinine clearance. What about Kidugo again, about diabetic? We have to consider what's the recommendation in Kidugo. So they consider modification of the immunosuppression regime to reverse and ameliorate diabetes after weighting the risk of rejection and the potential adverse effect. And also to consider targeting HbA1c from 7 to 7.5 and avoiding targeting very low HbA1c, especially in hypoglycemic reaction, which is hypoglycemic reaction is very common. And they suggested patients with both transplant diabetes to give aspirin 65 to 100 milligram in order to avoid cardiovascular disease after transplantation and the risk of the ischemia, which again, some people like to use aspirin and some people don't like it. So what's the clinical impact of post-transplant diabetes? It is the patients exhibit similar complications. And like anyone who have diabetes for a long time, type 2, he can have the same complication, but it will be accelerated more, not like the normal pathway of the diabetes and the complication in diabetes, like diabetic retinopathy, nephropathy, it will be more fast if he developed post-transplantation. So there is a major risk of a cardiovascular event, there is a major risk of graft failure, and this as well. So, and again, hyperfiltration is believed to be negatively impact the allograft survivor, and patients with diabetic may develop microvascular complications, and it will be more rapidly than the patient with non-transplant-related diabetic. So we have to deal with them like diabetic, but aggressively, because the disease is very aggressive, more than what we expect. In summary, post-transplant diabetes is common, potentially preventable. We can do something even to avoid it. And we have to screen the patient post-transplant, not only just to give transplant and leave him. We have to think about he may develop diabetes at any time post-transplantation. And should all the patients should be counseling regarding the risk of to develop post-transplant diabetes. And immunosuppression adjustment is very important, and it is case to case. Every case is different, and we have to, when we adjust the immunosuppression, we have to think about any risk of acute rejection. By this, I thank you very much, and I'm ready to answer any question.
Thank you very much, Professor Faisal Shaheen, for this very comprehensive. You cover the topic from the definition up to the end of the management. I have some comments, but I prefer to start with Professor Halawa. So unmuting Professor Halawa, Dr. Halawa.
Thank you, Professor Shaheen, for this elegant lecture. Actually, you know, as my colleague Hussein mentioned, you covered it and you made it to look very easy. You know, and you cover most, you know, even, you know, all the aspects of post-trans diabetes. But I have one comment here, because, you know, when we come to diabetes and kidney transplant, I do worry about patient survival rather than graft survival. Because, you know, after 3 years of developing diabetes, all the kidneys, all the graft will get diabetic changes, but not necessarily to, you know, the graft will get lost. You know, the chances of losing a graft from diabetes, of recurrence of diabetes, around 4 to 5%, maximum 10%. But I would like to stress on the point that, you know, the patient might lose his life before losing his graft. Do you agree with this statement, or, you know, because, you know, we deal with different, you know, genetic background here. You know, in UK, most of the population are white, and the chance of diabetes is quite slim compared to Arabs and Afro-Caribbean. You know, the American as well, you can tell, because there's a mixed race. You know, the incidence of diabetes varies from based on the ethnicity. So what do you think, Professor Shaheen, regarding this statement? Is it applicable to the Arab world as well?
I think it is the same, all of the same. Frankly, the patient, even if he had cancer, which is a different mentality, he's looking for transplant. And he know that he will just only stay for a couple of months or something. He is still nagging for transplant. Mm. If some patient develop a disease, post-transplantation, which is like diabetes, it is the same. We have to think about his life. Even in a bad quality, still they accept it. But not to return back to dialysis, not to stay. Let the diabetes, I can deal with diabetes, I can. We have so many patients from different cultures as well in Saudi Arabia. Because we have nationality, we have maybe 51 nationality in Saudi citizen here, it's 9 million people. Still, they have almost the same mentality, the same things which you have. Their life is important. Whatever during their life, what's happening, what's going on, diabetes, hypertension, whatever, they can deal with it. Mm. So I agree with you 100%.
Thank you, Professor Shaheen.
So if anyone wants to share in the discussion, please raise your hand to just unmute. Dr. Gawad, yes. Dr. Gawad. Okay, regarding the point that Professor Halawa mentioned, diabetes may affect the patient survival. This is why graft survival, if we make death censored graft survival, you will find no difference between diabetes and others. So diabetes affects graft survival through patient's death. So it increases. But I think the healthcare system now is improved significantly than in the past. So the outcome of transplantation nowadays in diabetic patients, even if they are diabetic before transplantation, is better than in the past. And we have here at Mansoura Urology and Nephro Center, our experience is post-transplant diabetes affects transplant outcome associated by all major macrovascular complications. And I want to just to have a comment about tacrolimus level, because we started here tacrolimus since mid-90s. And when we started tacrolimus at that time, we used the high level. So we target from 15 to 30 nanogram per ml at that time. And we witnessed a lot of diabetic ketoacidosis. After Symphony trial and after changing our practice toward the modest and the low target of tacrolimus, nowadays everything is fine, to the extent that diabetes, although I don't have real statistics now, but from my experience, it is declining to be diagnosed. Regarding steroid withdrawal, we have significant number of transplanted that we are succeeded to rapid discontinue prednisone after a week of transplantation. But I agree with Professor Faisal 100%. We should not jeopardize graft outcome. So we should balance the risk, and the wisdom is to handle immune suppression case by case. Professor Faisal.
I agree with you, Hussein, actually. This is very important point. Just don't rock the boat. Sometimes if someone is stable with a lowish dose of immunosuppression, it is not advisable by any means just to move the small dose of steroid or something and you think. There are many rejections cases happen long time back in 2006, 2007, when they were thinking about immune suppression cessations completely. And as I mentioned, that it was from GD Briggs, he announced that even low dose, 5 milligrams steroid, please keep it, otherwise you will lose a lot of patients, a lot of graft. So I'm still thinking that even five, maybe someone said five will not do anything. No, it is. Sometimes it works. Even if we have it with arthritis, 5 milligram change the life of so many people. If they have arthritis and you give 5 milligram, they start to walk again. So again, we should not, if you don't remove your steroid therapy from the start early, don't remove it after that. This is my own experience. If I give the steroid in the first 3 months and then I hold it and then the graft continue, it's very good. But if someone after 2 years, he is in a small dose of steroid, I have to think 1,000 times to remove this steroid.
Thank you very much. Dr. Tariq Tantawi, I want to chair. Dr. Tariq, unmute. Yes, Tariq.
Yes. Really, I'm enjoyed to your practical approach, Dr. Faisal. I am really enjoyed too much. But I would like to give a hint about obesity.
Yes.
We are in a challenge prior to transplantation, and especially after transplantation, with gaining weight. I think with approach to manage, I give the privilege to metformin, DDP4 inhibitors, and sodium glucose transporter with all precaution about drug-drug interaction with immunosuppressive drugs. What about your opinion about it? I am sure early post-transplant with hyperglycemia, regular insulin or short-acting insulin will be the upper hand. But with maintenance hypoglycemic drugs, I think I give to this the priority to manage diabetes and to avoid obesity.
Dr. Faisal.
Okay. Oh, thank you. Okay. I agree with you, Tariq, but immediately post-operative, you can't give metformin. But for the long term, after stabilization, and you know exactly that your patient can be shifted from insulin to oral hypoglycemia, and then you chose metformin because of the obesity also, so at least the patient will not become obese. I agree with you, but how much the GFR? If the GFR is low, you have to think carefully about this. If the GFR is more than 30, I think you can give it easily, and you can, because you know we try to avoid any other component which can make a problem with him, like acidosis or something.
If you allow me, Professor Faisal, regarding obesity, we don't like obesity before or after transplantation. And we experienced it here and in a study that was published since many years that gaining weight after transplantation was associated with poorer outcome of transplantation in general. And more interesting, we found that gaining weight after kidney donation, this in live kidney donors, diabetes increase. And so this is why we should include and incorporate education of the donors not to gain weight after donation, because this will increase the risk of diabetes and may increase the risk of renal failure after kidney donation. Another point is the original kidney disease. We observed that polycystic kidney disease may be associated with increased risk of diabetes. This may be due to insulin resistance, and in few patients, there may be cysts in pancreas and something like that. So what's your opinion and comment about these points, Dr. Faisal?
Well, polycystic, you know, it is something which is accompanied with diabetes. But we can't do anything with them. If you have some patient with polycystic disease, you should tell them, and at least not to add another risk to increase his weight after transplant, because he is prone to have diabetes post-transplant. I have few patients which is polycystic and they don't develop diabetes, but they are doing fine without diabetes. But I could have some which have accompanied diabetes and polycystic kidney disease. For the obesity, both in donor and recipient, everyone now and every center started to put, before going for transplant, to put target for good and low BMI acceptable for transplantation. So if the donor willing to donate, he will go and decrease his weight. If the recipient willing to have a kidney, he will go and reduce his weight before even transplantation. So something which can manageable before. But still, even like now with this COVID lockdown, everyone become obese, not only the transplant patient.
Yes,
So it's become difficult to lose weight after that. So, but still, obesity is very, very bad. And even, and we have Professor Hala with us, and the surgeon is going, where he go to put the kidney, and then and again, suturing and infection. And so we have to avoid this. Better to keep them till they become slim and to get a transplant.
Before I give Dr. Halawa the comment, I want just to continue Dr. Tarek Tantau's comments about the management of diabetes post-transplantation. Management of diabetes after transplantation should be holistic, addressing risk factors. And as Professor Faisal mentioned, we should discriminate between immediate post-transplant period and on the maintenance period. And there is a nice classification of the duration after transplantation. The first 45 days are the days for insulin. And not only regular insulin, as Dr. Tarek mentioned, intermediate insulins are fantastic, and they proven to protect the islets of the pancreas. So in the immediate 45 days, insulin. After that, we treat from 45 to the first year, and after the first year, we treat as type 2 diabetes. In the first 45 days, we diagnose by plasma glucose and oral glucose tolerance test. From 45 days up to the end of the first year, A1C may underestimate the diagnosis. A1C is excellent after the first year of transplantation. Dr. Faisal, what?
I agree with you 100%. I think yes. You make it very easy and simple how to follow up the patient post-transplant. Yeah. Excellent.
Thank you. Very much. Dr. Halawa.
Actually, it's a comment and a question. A comment, yes. I agree with Professor Faisal regarding steroids, because what we do here in Sheffield, the minimum dose of steroid the patient will reach is 5 milligrams. We never stopped steroid completely. The question So I know the practice in Saudi Arabia. What about your practice, Professor Hussein? Do you stop steroid completely, steroid free, no steroids at all, or steroid minimization?
The question is to me or Dr. Faisal?
No, to you. Actually, we do the same as Professor Faisal mentioned, but what about you, your transplant center in Mansoura?
Since many years, when we have our the randomized controlled trial to test steroid, rapid steroid discontinuation, so what we do, we give the patient the pulse steroid before declamping, and then to continue by our protocol for 7 days, and then to stop altogether steroid. No steroid after the 7th day, provided that the tacrolimus level is fine. And we learned that when we stop prednisolone, tacrolimus level may even increase because prednisolone is enzyme inducer. So if there is adequate level, we stop by the 7th day. If we fail to have a therapeutic level of tacrolimus within after 2 weeks of transplantation, we continue on a small dose of steroid forever. So this is our policy. And it was dedicated for children to allow growth and for adults with low immunological risk. So we don't think of steroid discontinuation for retransplant patients or patients with high anti-HLA antibody, even if it's donor non-specific, or those who have high mismatch above 3 to 6 mismatch. For these people, we continue steroid as a steroid maintenance protocol. Okay. But for those with low immunological risk, and especially for children, and children may even not coping with low immunological risk, but we make the balance to allow growth because, as you know, growth hormone is not welcomed at all in the first year after transplantation. So our primary protocol for low immunological risk, either children or adult, is to induce the patient by basiliximab, then starting steroid, tacrolimus, mycophenolate for 7 days, then stopping the steroid altogether.
Yeah. I have another question.
Dr. Halaw, and our protocol is evolved because in the early few years, if the patient experiences acute rejection, we treat rejection with pulse steroid. Then we continue steroid-free protocol. If the patient develops second rejection episode, we continue steroid forever. But nowadays, after the first episode of rejection, we treat rejection by steroid and continue steroid forever.
Yeah. Anyway, I mean, there's nothing called one size fits all. It depends on the the patient you're dealing with. Genetic background, it makes a difference. The race makes a difference. The social and other differences, of course, come to play. But I'm always concerned since I started the Korean transplantation about the intraoperative pulse steroid. We give a 0.5 gram intravenous.
Yes.
For you and Professor Shaheen, I couldn't find any evidence actually to support giving this dose of steroid. You know, it's just something picked from the air, and we keep doing it without even thinking it's what's the effect. Can we stop? And even myself, I didn't have the courage. I'm not brave enough to stop not giving it. I wonder if Professor Shaheen and you, Professor Hussein, have an idea about any supporting evidence to support giving intraoperative steroids.
Dr. Faisal.
Well, I think again immunologically they found that steroid needed once you decline because of they're afraid from some sort of rejection, and there is, as you said, that these trends which continue to be done in many places, in many centers. Myself, I still going with this till today, and I add for it cyanoglobulins, ATG, one dose intraoperative as well. This is just only to avoid to have any sort of rejection. Probably I don't know either I mistake or not, but I found that if someone I don't give cyanoglobulin intraoperative or I will be hesitant. So if the urine output usually low, it will take time to pick up the kidney. But if I give it, usually everything is okay. I don't have any problem post-operative. So that's why I get used to this since many years. I, you know, probably I'm from the first people who start to use ATG, a high dose intraoperative. It was 9 mg/kg at that time, one dose, one single dose only, very long time back. And I continue to have this in a lowish dose, not like before. But if I didn't give it intraoperative, I don't know why the patients have some sort of delayed functions, or I don't know. And I have to obliged to do it again, to give it 1 day or 2 days after transplant. So it is some sort, probably psychologically, probably it is some evidence, basic medicine evidence that you may get some sort of rejection, which you don't know, some minimal rejection, which can destroy the graft. And that's why the people just to hit this immunological action before it happens.
Yeah, I think I totally agree with you, Professor Faissal. In many occasions, we do a lot of things driven by our feeling rather than evidence. But we can't wait for evidence, because medicine won't be evolving if it is based on randomized controlled trials. It will never happen, because even the transplant itself is not a randomized operation. It is just a case report. Somebody did it and it did work, and we followed what he did. So if it works, means successful. So
if you allow me, Professor Halawa, sometimes it is impossible to accept a randomized controlled trial as a brochure study. True, so actually, what we do is pulse steroid before the clamping. And in the past, we give even one pulse steroid at the night before transplantation. But we stop it now. So it is we give the 500 milligram misalprednisolone in intravenous infusion, not bolus, because bolus misalpred may lead to catastrophes. So infusion during anesthesia before the clamping. And since 15 years, we published our experience in giving bolus ATG, 9 mg/kg, at the time of transplantation intraoperative, under the umbrella of anesthesia, we give 9 mg/kg as single bolus dose and induction, but for few cases, and it was published since 15 years. But we stopped this policy because we don't have high immunological risk patients. And we use now thymoglobulin for intermediate risk patients. But for low risk, we use basiliximab for thinking for steroid discontinuation. By the way, there is two observational studies showing that basiliximab may be associated with increased risk of post-transplant diabetes. And they augmented this hypothesis. It is observational study, not interventional, but they augmented this by a study in animal. When they block interleukin 2 in animal, this increased diabetes in animal. This increased the association hypothesis of basiliximab with post-transplant diabetes. I'm not sure, and I'm not aware, that thymoglobulin or ATG can increase the risk of post-transplant diabetes. Dr. Faissal.
I think, you hit another topic, which is, I don't like to expand on it. I published a paper last month in American Journal of Nephrology about, meta-analysis of basiliximab versus no basiliximab.
Yes.
And there is no evidence to support giving basiliximab. However, there is the hole of this study is we're missing rejection, because it's so registry data, so we didn't get the acute rejection, but graft survival 1 year and 5 years are the same. And I have a big concern in terms of cost implication of using basiliximab, right, blindly, especially basiliximab was introduced in cyclosporin and other thiopurine era rather than tacrolimus and MMF. And I'm glad that you say basiliximab can give diabetes as well. I will look for these papers then.
in two observational studies, I can forward the reference. I want just not to lose the opportunity to have Professor Faissal Shaheen with us, and he is the President-elect of International Society of Organ Donation and Procurement. And
I'm the president now.
Yeah, you are the president. Yes. Okay. But on Sulaiman al-Faqih, still president-elect up to 2021. So please correct. Okay. You are the president because I went to the conference. And it is our honor that one of the Arab figures and legends is the president of this very important society. And we are dreaming to have cadaveric donor transplantation program to work effectively in Egypt in the future. But I don't like to lose the opportunity to open some points in the hot issue that we are living today is COVID-19. And here at Eurasian Nephro Center, we discontinued and stopped transplant program since 11th of March. So now we have 2 months and a half without transplantation, new cases. And we are thinking to sit together with surgery, with the surgeons and medical person to decide when to restart the program. And I know from the literature in Austria, they started in the middle of April transplantation by certain precautions. And I'd like to hear from you, Professor Faisal, your concepts in these points.
Well, I think it's very important one. I am with a group from different places in the world looking for transplantation, especially from Canada. The group is formed from Canada, Montreal, Professor Sam, which is head of the transplantation from Intensive Care Society, plus USA, plus Germany, Austria, Italy, UK, and Spain. So we have virtual meeting every week to look about transplantation and donation worldwide. And also Australia with us and many other people, actually very important people in their country. And what I noticed that the people doesn't like to have what we have now. Now we lock down everything, even transplantation. In Saudi Arabia, only 2 centers or 3 centers are doing transplant, deceased donor and living donor in the patient which is in need. But otherwise, every center is closed. Even myself, the first things I did, I had to close the transplantation till I see what's going on after COVID. But what I can notice internationally, that the people don't like to stop. They want to continue. And even in very hot places of COVID and mortality, they started to reopen again, full force. I will start by USA. USA, the curve come down after, you know, everyone know the high mortality and things, and then pick up again, and now they return back to normal. Especially in Florida, in LA, in some countries, even they have more donations rate than before now at the moment, this last week meeting. And in Italy, they start again, open the doors last week, and then their curve come up again to be even better than COVID era. In Spain, the same, but Spain give a different experience. Spain.
Excuse me, Professor Faisal. Excuse me. Yeah. Do you mean by restarting kidney transplantation or other organ transplantation?
All.
Yes, yes. Living and cadaveric.
Living and cadaveric.
Okay.
Even in Italy, in Spain, they have a good experience. Too many patients transplanted center, and they have 26% of their patients became positive COVID, but no mortality. Which again encourages them to go further and to do the transplantation as before, and the curve start to come up again. So in short, in many countries they return back again to have a transplant, and they expect that some of those patients may develop COVID, but not so seriously in order to lead to death. It can happen, but especially in Spain, 26% is very high to have in the recipient, but yet they are continue their work, and their work is very successful as going up. myself, I am making some survey here in Saudi Arabia to see which center start, which center going to open. And I think if we have a place where we can, very restricted area, not to be with the COVID people or COVID ward in a hospital, we can restart again the program. Myself, I'm saying to restart again within 2 weeks from now.
So what are the extraordinary precautions and the prerequisites to allow restarting?
Well, I think, again,
screening a donor and recipient, is it mandatory?
Oh, yes. Okay. This is important. Screening is important. Serological screening, by the way, some people were suggesting it, but it is not.
Yes.
Everyone said no serological screening, just only the COVID, and you have to screen the donor and the recipient as well, before transplantation. And if they are negative, go ahead. Still, there is a question about negative to positive and the positive to negative. Still, there is something about this either to go, because it is not shown that it can be transmitted by blood. So they don't afraid from this. They said that blood is out, so just under droplet infection, and that's why we should avoid anything to go with this. So if we have dedicated area for transplant, which is the people, you know that who is going, who is entering. You know, in our hospital, they say no one go to ICU at all. Family, it's forbidden to go to ICU till yesterday. There's no family to any patient ICU. But your patient is post-transplant, is critical. You need to put him in a dedicated area where he can have like ICU management, and in case he need it, he can have fluid management, which people who get used to it, which usually they are ICU nurse and ICU doctor. And now if your ICU is full of COVID, you have to look for another place. So this is what I mean. I mean that I have to look for another place, no COVID, negative COVID, and the area is separated, and I can do the transplant. Why not?
Okay.
Again, as ISODP president, I really was afraid that the organ donation would be dramatically come down and never pick up. But it seemed that it's picking up again. And in especially in the area where it was a very hot area, like Spain and Italy. And New York itself. New York restart again the transplant, and in all the center in USA, they start from the last week.
Okay, Dr. Halawa, do you want to add anything about this point?
No, we follow the same. Actually, we're going to start hopefully 1st of June. Uh-huh. And we have a plan, so screening, we selected very low risk recipients. So the waiting list came down from 220 to only 33. So we excluded the high BMI from transplantation in the next few months. We excluded patients with, high comorbidities, multiple comorbidities. We start screening them while on the waiting list and be screened on the day of admission. Again, deceased donor transplant, no living, because we're still, the living program in UK is not popular compared to the deceased donor. 80% of transplant, our transplant is deceased donor transplant, 20% only living. So we prefer to leave the living donation a bit. Let us start with the deceased donation and see how it goes. Also, as Professor Shaheen mentioned, actually there's a clean pathway. So there's no relatives, no contact with other patients. So we have isolated the transplant wards completely from general nephrology patients. Also, they're going to screen us as well.
Yes, this was the last question to Professor Shaheen. Is it mandatory to screen healthcare workers, doctors and nurses who are working in transplant care?
Well, I think if anyone develop any symptom, he should be screened. The policy in the hostel is if anyone is sick, he report himself and he will be screened.
Yes. It is not mandatory to have screening for healthy asymptomatic persons.
No, it is not.
Yes.
Till now, but I think by what Professor Ahmed mentioned, maybe it will become mandatory that because the patient also has the right that you are also negative. So ethically, maybe it will be mandatory if we screen every patient.
Okay, yeah. Let us look briefly to the chat questions. HCV infection is a big issue in post-transplant diabetes. Yes, it is a big issue for diabetes and post-transplant diabetes, HCV and CMV, both of them. What do they use for induction in Egypt? Cambeth, we used it and we published naive, humble cases, but nowadays it is either basiliximab or thymoglobulin or ATG. So Simulect is the commonest used nowadays. Is there a link between IVIG and rituximab and diabetes? I'm not aware. Dr. Faisal, do you want to comment about rituximab and IVIG and the risk of diabetes?
Well, I think IVIG also something which maybe can brought to diabetes, but this is IVIG, you give it only temporarily. Not. And rituximab, if you give it, it affects the B cells and it would be leukopenia, so it doesn't have any effect in the diabetes. Okay. Rituximab.
I think now we reached the end of this session, and I have no words to express my gratitude and appreciation to Professor Faisal Shaheen for your excellent presentation, very comprehensive, and your patience with us in the discussion. So it was a really wonderful session, and all of us appreciating your presence with us. And I think Professor Halawa is smiling. This means he's very satisfied by the presentation and discussion. And I invite both of you and Professor Halawa and all the colleagues with us today to meet us with Professor Rashad Barsoom tomorrow, 8 p.m. Cairo time, because he will speak 30 minutes about COVID-19 and kidney, and then 1.5 hour discussion. I'm sure that the presence of Professor Shaheen with us tomorrow will enrich this discussion, and we will discuss again and again the role of transplantation, because as you mentioned, you are now the president of the Society of Donation and the Procurement. So, and this is a very hot topic. So, yes, leaving the patient on dialysis is very terrible for us and for patients. And I think it is mandatory to start transplantation, but in safe grounds. So let us meet again tomorrow to discuss.
Hussein, we need to think about COVID 20 and COVID 21 as well.
Oh, it's enough. Yes. Enough from 19.
يعني اسمح لي انهي اذا ما بدات باللغه العربيه انهي باللغه العربيه. احنا طبعا دكتور فيصل في القلب مننا شخصيا ومن السي ام اي شابتر بالجامعه المصريه ومن كل الناس اللي معانا اللي سمعوا حضرتك واللي هيشاهدوا البرزنتيشن على اليوتيوب. احنا حبناك من قبل وحبناك النهارده اكتر.
الله يسلمك.
وان شاء الله تبقى دي بدايه تعاون مثمر ونتقابل ونتبادل الخبرات مع شخصيه عظيمه وخاصه ان انت واحد مننا، انت خريج طب المنصوره. شكرا دكتور فيصل، واسيب حضرتك تنهي الحلقه.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. اولا اشكرك دكتور حسين، واشكر جميع الاخوه والاخوات اللي أخذوا من وقتهم ليشوفوا هذه المحاضرة، وأرجو أن أكون إن شاء الله أكون وفقت في أن أوصل ولو معلومة صغيرة لأي أحد منكم. وأنا سعيد جدا أن أكون معكم، لأن أنا منكم زي ما ذكر الدكتور حسين، منكم وإليكم، وعسى إن شاء الله أن هذه الجائحة تنتهي على خير ونعود للقاء وجها لوجه مستقبلا بإذن الله سبحانه وتعالى. أشكركم جميعا وأشكر الجمعية على استضافتها للإخوان في العالم العربي ككل، وهذا شيء جيد الحقيقة، لأن مصر أم الدنيا، فأنت الأم ونحن وراءك.
وأنت في القلب، وأشكرك وأشكر الجميع، ونشوفكم دائما على خير، والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
عليكم السلام.
مع ألف سلام. مع سلامة الله.
السلام.
مع السلامة.